Hi, good people at APA. I want to thank you for attending my session. And I also want to thank APA and particularly Anne Huffman for the invitation to present to you today. I am a discrimination researcher, but today I am going to present on something that I feel is so incredibly important that also includes discrimination. So I'm going to take a broader approach. That's something I don't typically do in my talks, but I feel like my students' behaviors over the last few years has really necessitated this. And I am sure that many of you connect with me in feeling this. So I want to begin by asking you, who do you think are the loneliest Americans? As this article says, the answer may surprise you. It is our Gen Zers, or what we call now Zoomers. They're kids 6 to adults 24 years of age. These include today's college students. And what we know is these younger generations are lonelier than the older generations. Nearly 8 in 10 Gen Zers, 79%, and 7 in 10 millennials, 71%, are lonely, as compared to with a still high number of the boomers, which is 50%. This is not the result of one study. This is the result of many studies, and there was just recently a study conducted in 47 countries by Manuela Barreto and colleagues that showed similar patterns. And what we know is that in our young people, deep friendships are becoming rarer. The problem with loneliness is many. It's related to many negative health outcomes. 50% increase in risk of dementia, 29% increase in risk of heart disease, 32% increase in risk of stroke, increased depression, anxiety, and suicide. In fact, John Cacioppo, the belated John Cacioppo, spent the majority of the latter part of his life studying the implications of loneliness and found that it increases the risk of premature death. And we know that the risk is as great as smoking cigarettes, being obese, and other negative life circumstances. Not only are our college students lonely, but what we know is mental health issues are flaring. First of all, by the time they get to college, and this data is pre-pandemic, by the time they get to college, 75% of, well, I should say by the time they're 24, 75% of people with mental health illnesses are going to reveal themselves. So they're going to have many of these students come to college with a pattern of established mental health problems. 1/3 of college freshmen arrive with this. 67% of women and 54% of men felt very lonely in a study that was done in the past year. 60% have an overwhelming level of anxiety. 42% said that they were so depressed that they could not function. And the graduate students report depression and anxiety at rates 6 times higher than that of the general population. Today, I want to talk about the mental health challenges of our current college students. And I want to talk about what is exacerbating, what is exactly happening to our students that are leading to such mental health challenges. And I want to identify the perfect storm of at least 4 factors. And then I want to think about how we can, as professors and clinicians, help students reduce or manage their adversity. I want to think about how we can react to this storm. When I talk about the first threat to mental health, I think about the transition to college, or what I refer to as post-adolescent identity crisis, a time when individuals are still trying to figure out who they are, what major, what career they want to do. And it's also compounded by the major stress of moving. So some people claim that college is the best 4 years of your life. Well, college involves moving, going to often a new location where the students know no one, living alone for the first time, changes in eating and sleeping behaviors, challenging course loads, the imposter syndrome, trying to fit in, and social comparisons. And all of these stressors are often exacerbated if the students come from vulnerable backgrounds, such as first generation, low SES, and students of color. In the words of a recent college student, she said, a lot of people on college campuses have the sense that I have to work and be busy all the time. I can never do enough work, and everyone else is doing so much work. And if I don't work all the time, and if I don't keep up, I'm not going to be smart. I'm not going to have a good life. I'm not going to be successful. These students often feel like they can't even spare the time to check in with friends. The second threat is the way that they do check in with their friends, and this is often through social media. The impact of social media is great. It's linked to depression, anxiety, poor sleep quality, lower self-esteem, inattention, and hyperactivity. Now, the research is multidirectional, which means increased social media has been linked to all of these negative outcomes, and increases in these negative outcomes has been linked to increases in social media. However, recent research has shown that there is a causal effect of social media actually resulting in these negative outcomes as well. One of the reasons is that individuals who are looking at social media see such curated images. They know that they're fake, but they can't help asking, how does my life compare to this? They know they're doctored. They know that they don't represent individuals' everyday experiences, but these upward social comparisons become problematic. We also know in research that Instagram may be one of the worst social medias for mental health. It's particularly associated with high levels of anxiety, depression, bullying, and FOMO, or the fear of missing out. I've indicated some articles that talk about this, but again, I'm going to give a student a voice by saying it's contrived images and edited clips ranked against each other. It's a system based on social approval, likes, validation, in views, success in followers. It's perfectly orchestrated, self-absorbed judgment. What you can see is Instagram leaves individuals feeling like beautiful pictures from a vacation are the most important thing. Yes, this is what my face really looks like. I can afford this, and I'm doing great. It also shows us a non-realistic ideal, particularly body image ideals, that we know is linked to more body image issues. Now, when we talk about social media, I also want to pause and talk about the cell phone. And our life has really been uprooted. Our societal changes that have occurred because of the cell phone are immense. And I want to think about the influence that it has on loneliness and mental health as well. And I think of no better way to do it than by showing you artist Eric Pickersgill's series of photos that remind viewers how strange this pose actually is. This series is called Removed, and what you see is by looking at their cell phones, they're often ignoring the beautiful surroundings or opportunities for human connection. And if you think about this happening at a societal level, we're losing our profound importance of looking at each other, relating, and interacting. What's particularly sad is that we see this at a very, very young age. The third threat to mental health is the global pandemic. We know that the global pandemic has brought housing and food insecurity, financial hardships, social connectedness, a lack of sense of belonging, uncertainty about the future, access and technology, impeding academic performance and well-being, and sickness and deaths of family members. And all of these issues are exacerbated for inequalities for students of color and low-income students. There have been, due to the global pandemic, unprecedented rates of mental illness. So this was a study that was taken in the fall of 2020, and it just asks college students to indicate which of the following mental or emotional health challenges have they experienced in the past month. And as you can see, 82% report anxiety, 68% social isolation and loneliness, 63% depression, and you can see suicidal thoughts are at 18%. So a lot of mental health issues. Now, when we say, well, let's compare this to pre-pandemic, in the same survey, they asked college students, how would you say your emotional health has been compared to before the outbreak? And you see 19% said it was far worse and 43% said it was somewhat worse than before. Now, I do want to take a moment and say that sometimes when life gives you terrible lemons, you do make some lemonade. And I do think that when the pandemic is behind us, we will see that students and all adults do report that there are some benefits. So thank goodness that we have had cell phones and computers during this time, or else we would have had to pause much of our life as we know it. It's also led to increased self-directedness and autonomy in students. It's led to immense increased flexibility, an extra amount of time that many individuals get from the lack of commuting. It's led to increased family time. And as again, a student responded, it's led to increased Zoom study sessions and attempts to reach out. So the quote here is, we sometimes would have Zoom study sessions, and I feel like we grew closer together as a family, kind of because we felt like we were going through this together. Nobody was alone, and we had the support that we needed. I think when we think about students and what they're experiencing, there can be two big issues. Of course, the physical sickness and deaths related to COVID are a third one that's huge. But I think the two other grappling issues are that social isolation is a threat. Loneliness is awful. But so too is being physically close to each other. And the second is that ambiguity is often interpreted as danger, and we simply don't know. Our students don't know about the future. The fourth threat to mental health is clearly the racial reckoning. And even as our APA president has said, we are living in a racism pandemic. I had the pleasure of talking during last year's celebration of Juneteenth, and I wrote an article with 13 of my current and former students who are pictured here. And we wrote an article called Anti-Racist Actions and Accountability, Not More Empty Promises. And in this article, we highlighted a few points. First of all, that most Black students are simply exhausted. The second, that racism has real psychological and physiological effects. And the third, that racism extends beyond police brutality. So we see it in the labor market, in housing, in education, in healthcare, and the criminal justice system. And we know this cumulative disadvantage extends across generations, across a single domain, and across domains here. We also know that it exists in college. And my own research has shown some of this biases. This is one particular study where we've looked at intra-group racism, and we see a colorism effect where actual advisors suggest that less stereotypically looking Black should take STEM classes. Now, one of the upsetting things is that colleges often fail to understand how societal racism affects mental health, and this has resulted in the fact that there's a mental health care gap between people, students of different races. We also know this is not just a stressful time for Black students, but it's a stressful time also for Asian students. Anti-Asian hate crimes have increased nearly 150% in 2020, and we know the mental health impact of anti-Asian racism is also very serious. In fact, the threat to mental health is great for students of all races. And when we see this study done on college students that asks students how concerned they are with the following, you can see the thing that they're most concerned about is how long the pandemic will last. But the second thing that they cite is racial unrest in this country. 61% of students are extremely or very concerned, and 29% are slightly or moderately concerned. And if we look, we also see that 79% are concerned to some extent about racial unrest in community. So what we have is a college student who has the perfect storm, the stresses of the college transition, of social media, of the pandemic, and of racial reckoning. And so now what we want to ask is, how can we connect and reduce or help students manage adversity? And first thing I want to say is, when I looked at the research, I didn't find a ton of research showing what is effective for faculty to do. What we want to think about is, what can we do? What can we do to help the Sisyphean task of getting that rock up the hill, or of helping individuals manage or reduce their stress, their mental health issues? In a 2021 report by the National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine, the report suggested that a greater amount of university-wide attention was needed, and that it was critical for us to focus on campus counseling centers. And I want to quote Alan Leshner, the CEO emeritus of the American Association for the Advancement of Science, who said, "This is a terrible time financially for academic institutions, but it's essential they address this problem or their problems will only be compounded. For example, when students are experiencing emotional problems, they often drop out of school. So leave of absence and re-enrollment policies that ease readmission and financial aid continuation are just some of the policies that universities wide should consider adopting." He also suggests that faculty can and must play a role. He states, "Because they are in such a frequent contact with students, faculty have an under-acknowledged role in students' mental health. They need to be taught about teaching and mentoring practices that support students' well-being." So I'm going to give you 10 ways to connect with students in trying to manage, in trying to reduce adversity and to manage mental health. The first is to simply be aware. So be aware of this perfect storm and the things that I've said in this talk. Also be aware that there are especially vulnerable groups: women, younger students, students with pre-existing health concerns, students of color, first-generation students, students with financial difficulties, and students with family or community members who are infected with COVID-19. Two, get to know your students. It starts with day one. Get to know their names. Get to know some information. Many professors, me included, collect index cards or ask for two-minute videos of your students to learn some things about them and really start to get to know them. Allow for touch points. Schedule time to process what's going on in terms of stress and to connect with them. I actually ask my students to come to one, I ask them, "I would like you to come to at least one office hour. And if you don't have anything to talk about, we can talk about your future, your career, or anything you have in the class that you want to talk about." The third is to recognize students in distress and be able to refer them to the appropriate people on campus. I am not asking faculty to play the role of counselor, but what we should be aware of is, what are the signs of distress? Now, many of you are at university settings where you can go to your university counseling center and get information about where, how you can recognize the student distress and where, what's the best referral method. And for many college campuses, that differs. So you should know what your plan of action is. This is a wonderful webpage that South Dakota State put out that tells us to think about behaviors in terms of three sorts of levels of awareness. The first level is some that indicates something might be wrong. So changing from good to poor performance on grades, a more depressed mood. A second level is behaviors that signal stronger emotional distress, such as unusual or exaggerated emotional response, asking for deadlines and consistent special consideration. And the third level is behaviors that obviously indicate crisis, such as highly disruptive, aggressive, hostile behaviors, loss of contact with reality, and overtly suicidal thoughts. And knowing these behaviors and looking at your students and knowing your students can help tremendously. The fourth is to keep it real, is to share person struggles that you have with your students, to let them know that they're not alone, so that they know your perspective taking and that you can give them micro affirmations about your vulnerabilities. For instance, UT Austin urges faculty to share areas where they've struggled and focus less on competition and more on learning and mastery of content. I like to give my graduate students in particular something that Lillian first calls the anti-vita. So we know that vitas and resumes are often accomplishments. The anti-vita is all the things that I didn't get, so that students can know it's not that all of these people in front of them are just great, but here's all the schools I didn't get into. Here's all the jobs that didn't hire me. Here's all the teaching awards I didn't get or all the research grants I didn't get. And that allows it to keep it real. And finally, there's an article by Emod and one by Lipson that gives seven other ways to connect. And I hope you'll read these articles on your own. But what I would like to say is highlight them. And they say that we should foster trustworthiness and transparency. We should clarify assignments and grading, be clear and transparent, but also be flexible. One of the things they suggest is have assignments due at 5 p.m. and not at midnight and not at 9 a.m. because having assignments due at midnight and 9 a.m. encourage students to stay up and not get the sleep that they so badly need. Facilitate relationship building, encourage students to check in on each other, to promote collaboration, to think about breakout rooms where students get to talk, where students get to share opinions, to validate and normalize concerns and ask questions such as, how can I help you learn during these difficult times? As I've said before, to pay attention to cultural, historical, and gender issues. And finally, to encourage a sense of purpose. So to reaffirm perhaps that I love teaching. I love doing research. What do they love? What are they excited about? What did they love to do? So that it helps to reaffirm their existence. I hope in this talk, I've showed you that for many college students, they feel like their present circumstance is a cave. And we as faculty members and also as clinicians can help students realize that it may feel like a cave, but in fact, it's a tunnel where if we help with their struggles and if we get them the help they need and if they can get the help they need, then they will see the light at the end of the tunnel. Thank you and be well.